Up in darkness, surrounded by silence. Oh, where have I gone? I woke to reality, losing its grip on me. Oh, where have I gone? I can see the light before I see the sunrise. You called and you shouted, broke through my deafness. Now I'm breathing in and breathing out, I'm alive again. You shattered
everyone joining us online for South Park Baptist Church. We're always glad to have you with us for another week. I want to share a passage out of Psalm 100 that has very much to do with what we're looking forward to this week. It says, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Here's the part that I love. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever. His faithfulness to all generations. He's always faithful. He's always good. He's always worthy of worship and thanksgiving. So let's remember that, not just this week, but as we continue on for the rest of the year. I got a special friend to introduce to you guys. He's going to be joining us in our service today. This is my friend Daryl Bailey. And you just wanted to say hello to everybody real quick.
I just want to say hi. My name is Daryl Bailey. I go to Light Christian Center here in Alvin, Texas. And I just want to say that God is good and he is faithful. And if you have anything in your heart, your desires or dreams, go after those dreams. Because God, with him, all things are possible. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Make us For the Lord's love, would you give him a hand of praise this morning?
All right, we don't have anybody special to welcome you today, just me, but I want to be sure and make sure you feel welcome. We're so glad to have everybody who's here with us now, and all you folks who are online, we're glad to have you too. We want to make sure that you know, I want to remind you that Pastor Chad does a thing called Weekly Shorts every Wednesday, and it's what happens in the Bible in Acts in between the sermon series that he does on Sundays. It's really good. Look on the church Facebook for that. Also, on Wednesday nights, Rodney McFarlane, whose birthday is today. I don't see Rodney, but it's his birthday. Rodney does a really good job on Wednesday nights, so we'd love to have you join in on that. All you folks at home, you can do that. Don't even have to leave your easy chair. We have a couple of other announcements. First of all, this Tuesday in the church lobby, Lori Bertrand is hosting Surviving the Holidays, which is part of the ministry called Grief Share. This is a wonderful help for those who have recently lost loved ones. So check with Chad, check the Facebook page, and see what time it starts. One more. South Park, this is special. South Park is holding a special Christmas event out in our backyard, and it's going to be called Country Christmas. It'll be Friday, December 11th from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock p.m. There'll be lots of fire pits, hayride, Christmas carols. Pastor Chad will share the Christmas story. Oh, man, we're going to make s'mores. Come for that. We're going to have homemade cookies, hot chocolate, coffee. It'll be a great outreach. Invite people. Be sure you come. Bring them with you. Be sure to bring your lawn chairs. And if you're able to volunteer to bring a fire pit, some firewood, bake some cookies, sign up on the link that's available on the church page, and we'll look forward to seeing you there. Now, enjoy the rest of the music and sing with us.
I think Gilbert's very special. I'm going to talk. Next, man. Next to my wife, you're my favorite person in the room, bro. Let's not downplay you. All right, hey, let's continue to worship one more time as we sing a very, very important, special song called Community.
Teach us to be community, Jesus. Teach us to be community. Unify our hearts as one. Unify our hearts as one. One church, one family, sharing with all, to each as they need it. One goal, one purpose, glory to God. Teach us to be community, Jesus. Teach us to be community. Unify our hearts as one. Unify our hearts as one. One Spirit, one counsel, move in your church.
Church, I've got the privilege to introduce y'all to a very special, important guest this morning. There's a friend of mine named Daryl Bailey, and he is a wonderful man of God. I find myself bumping into him at like a junior high basketball game or picking up food at a restaurant, and let me tell you something. Not only is he so encouraging, but he's so convicting to be around because he's always sharing about the love of Jesus with me, with anybody, a total stranger. And so I love his heart. I love his passion. Not only is he a great servant in his local church, but he's a great servant in the community. Daryl, I don't know if you remember telling me this when we first met a few years ago. You told me, Matt, whenever I was a young man, the police told me I need to leave town and never come back. And now the mayor of Alvin asked me to come pray before city council meetings. That's the power of God to change a life, right? Yeah, you can clap for that. I know. Aside from all the wonderful things he is, he's also an artist, and he loves to write poetry, and he's got his own book called Under Construction, Jesus Chief Cornerstone. What a title. And so he loves to do what's called spoken word poetry, and he's got a few of those that he wants to share with us this morning. So would y'all help me welcome Daryl Bailey. Brother, if you'll do me a favor, would you pray over our service and then share with us what you have?
Oh, Heavenly Father, we come to you right now, Father. Before we ask for anything, Father, we just want to say thank you and acknowledge who you are. You reign supreme, and there's nothing that you cannot do, Father. So I say a special blessing over this service today, Father. Ask you just anoint our hearts, Father, to receive the message that comes forth from Pastor Chad today, Father. We thank you, Father. So stir in us a good spirit, a right spirit, Father. It's all about you, King Jesus. We love you and thank you for what you're going to do today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. It's an honor and a privilege to be before you today. The song talked about community, and this is part of it. So I thank you. So the first poem I want to write is called So Focused. So Focused. I have never been more focused. My eyes are on the prize. So focused on the truth. I see right through your disguise. I have never been more focused. I'm being rebuilt. I'm under construction. So focused on my Jesus. He will bring an end to all corruption. I have never been more focused. The enemy doesn't stand a chance. So focused on my Father's business, waiting for new tactics and new plans. I have never been more focused, not distracted by rumors nor drama. So focused on what pleases the King. That's the end of that, period. No comma. And this one, when I think about centerpiece, this one's called Centerpiece. And the Lord is the centerpiece of my life. Centerpiece. My focus for today leads me in the right way. Unlike most, formed from a different kind of clay. Temptation all around, I'm prepared for my test. Mistakes will be made, I just gotta do my best. Some days will be hard. Some nights will seem long. I don't fit in this world, in a higher circle I belong. He knows my talents because he gave me my gifts. I don't worry about it. All my burdens he lifts. The level I'm on can be easily obtained. With him, nothing is impossible. He can break any chain. Forgiven of our sins, Jesus paid the price. He is my centerpiece for the rest of my life. Centerpiece. And this one, it's when the Lord orders your steps. When the Lord orders your steps, you walk in the sandals of the gospel of peace. When the Lord orders your steps, even when waves of life come rushing in, you're not afraid because deep calls out to deep. When the Lord orders your steps, what seems like a cliff, he provides a bridge. And he is a bridge over troubled waters, and I will testify that's who he is. When the Lord orders your steps, you walk without fear and keep the faith. And the joy that he planted in your heart will again reappear. God orchestrated our steps a long time ago, which means he went before us. So nothing's happened that he doesn't know. So let the Lord order your steps, and don't be afraid of the unknown, because when the Lord orders your steps, Holy Spirit guides you home. When the Lord orders your steps. Thank you, Pastor Chad. Thank you, Matthew. Thank you, South Park Baptist Church. There's one more that I would love to share to complete part of the vision that's happened right now as we speak. So if you would, this one is Hear My Voice. Surrender everything to God Give him your whole heart. Sometimes when praying, be quiet. Listen. And keep listening. And wait for his voice. He won't yell or scream to get your attention. He is a jealous God and also a gentleman. He is knocking at the door. Will you let him enter? Miracles happen when the Holy Spirit comes front and center. He is here, but don't listen with your ears. He's saying, I know you have been faithful for many of years. Don't give up now. Prepare for the harvest. You are a perfect painted picture, and Jesus Christ is the artist. United we stand, but divided we fall. Together we rise up, but separated we crawl. Refocus and revive. We must not drop the ball. I'm here. Are you listening? Better yet, will you answer my call? Hear my voice? Amen.
Well, thank you, Daryl. I don't think I need to preach after that, do I? No, don't get your hopes up. I'm still going. But we thank you. That was a wonderful word for us. So we go to the next part of the service. I want to start with a time of thanksgiving. We have Thanksgiving this week. And I just want to spend some time in prayer thanking God for who he is. And so it'll be a guided prayer time. I'll give you some things to pray about. And so as I do each subject, if you'll just pray those things to God, and we'll go through this time together. Heavenly Father, we come to you thanking you. First, Lord, we want to thank you for who you are. Lord, we look around us and we realize that you have blessed us. You've been gracious to us. So Lord, we want to acknowledge those blessings and that grace you've had in our lives. It's been a difficult year, but Lord, we know you are the one who has been with us each step along the way. So may we not forget that. May we thank you for the ways you've carried us through these times and other difficult times in our lives. We do thank you because you are loving and kind and gracious and slow to anger. You're forgiving. You want to have a relationship with us even after we turn our backs on you. We thank you for giving us this wonderful church family, South Park Baptist Church, to come alongside each other, to grow in our faith with each other, to serve you together. And we do thank you how you bring us through every step along the way of this journey. Lord, we know that you've been faithful in the past and you'll be faithful in the days ahead. Heavenly Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Who's made it to the midnight show? You know, the very first second you can see a movie. You have some of those movies in your life, like, I want to see this the very first second it comes out. I've done that a few times in my life. Probably the ones I remember the most vividly are The Lord of the Rings, right? And I showed up, I think probably the second one. I don't think I made it to the first one. The second one showed up for The Lord of the Rings first night, first second you could watch it, and I was underdressed. I was in jeans, a long-sleeve t-shirt, maybe a button-up casual shirt. It was December in Houston, who knows, maybe even just a regular t-shirt. But I was underdressed. I didn't know this was a costume party, right? I didn't know I was supposed to dress up like my favorite character. Now, to be fair, the people I was with, they didn't dress up either. But man, it's commitment, isn't it? You show up at midnight for a three-hour movie, that's commitment. It better be a good story. It better be an epic tale. It better be impressive. Otherwise, I'm not staying awake till 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm a night owl, and I'm not staying awake till 3 o'clock in the morning. There's some stories that captivate us, that draw us in, that make us feel like it's worth it, right? And then, well, we just do it sometimes for mediocre stories, don't we? How many of you stayed up way too late just watching YouTube videos or getting to the next episode on Netflix, right? Am I convicting anybody? And they're not even good stories, right? Well, we're staying up for nothing. Stories have a way of getting into us, good or bad. And out of all these stories, the epic, wonderful, amazing ones that we have, the amazing authors we have that can spin a yarn and captivate us and draw us in, we have one better. We have a story worth telling. We have the best story ever told. Do we tell that story? As we find in Acts chapter 26 today, as Paul tells his story. And get a running start into it. Like Gilbert said, if you caught the midweek short, you got the long version of this, the 10-minute version. I'll give you the 30-second version. Paul's coming off his third missionary journey. He makes it to Jerusalem there. He's in the temple. Some Jews from Asia, where he just came from, they point him out. They start a riot. They try to take him out of the temple and to kill him. The Roman tribune catches wind of this. He rushes in with soldiers. They take him back to the barracks to find out what's going on. And long story short, there's just all these plots and twists, and they send Paul to Caesarea to save him from sure death there in Jerusalem. And so Paul is in Caesarea under Governor Felix. He's ultimately on his way to Rome. That's where we pick up the story this morning. There under Governor Felix, he hears Paul's case and ultimately finds nothing wrong with Paul. But he keeps having Paul come in. And it says in Scripture that he's hoping that Paul will bribe him, that Paul will give him some money, and Paul never does. So when Felix leaves office, Festus is coming in as the next governor. He leaves Paul in prison as a favor to the Jews. And then so Festus comes in afterwards, and he's got Paul there, and he doesn't understand what's going on. He's new to the region. This is a backwater province for him. He doesn't understand the religion. He doesn't understand the dynamic. He doesn't know what's going on. And so he's trying to figure it out. He brings the religious leaders into Caesarea for a trial, and he doesn't think anything's wrong with Paul. He says, well, maybe we'll just go to Jerusalem. Maybe we can have a better understanding of what's going on if we get there. And Paul's like, take me to Rome. And he appeals to Caesar. So to Rome, he's going to go. But before he does, King Agrippa and his sister Bernice come to town to welcome the new governor. And they hear about Paul, and they want to hear what Paul has to say. And this isn't a trial. Paul's already going to Rome. This is entertainment. They want to hear a story. They want to be entertained. They want the court to come together and find out more about Paul. So they all gather together. Agrippa comes in with great pomp and circumstance, and there they come, and they want to hear what Paul has to say. So in Acts chapter 26, verse 1, we read, so Agrippa said to Paul, you have permission to speak for yourself. Then Paul stretched out his hand and made his defense. I consider myself fortunate that it's before you, King Agrippa, that I'm going to make my defense today against all the accusations of the Jews, especially because you are familiar with all the customs and controversies of the Jews. Therefore, I beg you to listen to me patiently. My manner of life from my youth, spent from the beginning among my own nation and in Jerusalem, is known by all the Jews. They have known for a long time, if they're willing to testify, that according to the strictest party of our religion, I've lived as a Pharisee. And now I stand here on trial because of my hope in the promise made by God to our fathers, to which our 12 tribes hope to obtain as they earnestly worship night and day. And for this hope I am accused by Jews, O King. Why is it thought incredible by any of you that God raises the dead? I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things in opposing the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And I did so in Jerusalem. I not only locked up many of the saints in prison after receiving authority from the chief priest, but when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. And I punished them often in the synagogues and tried to make them blaspheme. And in raging fury against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities. So Paul starts off his story. And he says to King Agrippa, I'm glad that it's before you that I get to make this defense today. Paul knows who Agrippa is. He has a great understanding of the man in front of him. And I dare say Agrippa probably knew who Paul was as well. See, Agrippa was King Herod Agrippa II. His father, King Herod, as he's often called, King Herod Agrippa I. But King Herod is the same King Herod who beheaded John the Baptist. It was the same King Herod that was a part of that circus of trials before Jesus was put to death. The same King Herod who had James killed. I mean, they probably worked together to persecute Christians, Agrippa's father and Paul, right? They were on the same team. And so this is also the same King Herod that just a few chapters before, if you'll remember, he claimed to be God, or actually the crowd claimed that he was God, and he didn't dissuade them, and he was put to death there on the spot. That was A.D. 44 when that King Herod died. And this one, King Agrippa, was 17 years old. So you know what that means? Agrippa was alive when Jesus died. He was a young child in King Herod's household when that trial took place. These are not things that are distant for King Agrippa. These are things that are close to home. Not only that, King Agrippa II, he's the great-grandson of Herod the Great, the one who rebuilt the temple, the one who was so jealous when wise men came and said there is one who has come, born king of the Jews, that he went and wiped out every boy 2 years and under in Bethlehem, hoping to put Jesus to death. Did you catch that? So this King Herod Agrippa's great-grandfather and father both wanted Jesus dead, and both tried to get him there. Right? But Jesus didn't stay dead, did he? That's the next part of the story. We'll get there later. So Agrippa II, who is he? Now he's king. He's probably 30 years old at this point in time. He doesn't have the same jurisdiction that his great-grandfather did, but he's over a lot of Gentile territories. But even more importantly, he's over Jerusalem. He's over the temple that his great-grandfather built. He's got the power to choose who the high priest is. He's the custodian of the temple treasury. If anybody understands what's going on in Jerusalem, Agrippa knows what's going on. And so what does Paul do? Paul appeals to their common Jewish ancestry. Now, Agrippa might not be as devout as Paul is, but he would know. He would know what the prophets said. He would know what the scriptures pointed to. And so Paul's saying, I'm just on trial because of what we've hoped for. And Agrippa would know the difference between a Pharisee and a Sadducee. He might side more for the Sadducees because they like the Herodians a little more. But nonetheless, he would know the difference. The Pharisees believed in resurrection. They believed in angels. They believed in spirits. The Sadducees, they didn't. They didn't believe there was resurrection. They didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in spirits. And he's saying, well, why wouldn't we want to believe in this? Why wouldn't we see this in Scripture? It is for the hope that the Pharisees have always said, the hope of the resurrection, the hope that there is truly life that comes from God. That's what I'm on trial for today. And so he's painting this context for Agrippa, saying, this is our heritage. This is our faith. This is not anything new, but this is what God has always wanted to carry out. And so should it be surprising to you that there's resurrection? Should it be surprising to you that that's the message that I have to preach today? And then Paul backtracks a little bit. He's like, but I wasn't always there, was I? I was right there with y'all. I was persecuting the church. I was seeking after them. I was putting my vote when they died. I was bringing them into prison. I was helping out. We were on the same team. And I think that's an important common ground for the next place that Paul gets in his story, because he gets to the heart of it in verse 12. He says, in this connection, I journeyed to Damascus with the authority and the commission of the chief priests. At midday, O king, I saw on the way a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, that shone around me and those who journeyed with me. When we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It's hard for you to kick against the goads. And I said, who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and stand upon your feet, for I've appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you as a servant and a witness to those in which you have seen me, and to those in which I will appear to you, delivering you from your people and from the Gentiles, to whom I am sending you, to open their eyes, so they may turn from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God. They may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. Therefore, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first to those in Damascus, then in Jerusalem and throughout all the region of Judea, and also to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God, performing deeds in keeping with their repentance. For this reason, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. To this day, I have had the help that comes from God. So I stand here testifying to both small and great, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would come to pass, that the Christ must suffer, and that by being the first to raise from the dead, he would proclaim light both to our people and to the Gentiles. So here Paul begins to tell his own story, doesn't he? He went from being the one who persecuted the church to meeting Jesus Christ on the road, and his life was changed forever. See, for Agrippa, what he's saying is, I used to be you, but I'm not anymore. So you don't have to be anymore. If my life can change, your life can change. Isn't that the great news of the gospel? If my life can change, your life can change. If Jesus can save me, he can save you too. And so Paul's saying, I used to persecute this church. There wasn't anybody much worse than me. Yes, sin's turning your back on God and going a different way and going my way instead of God's way. But I didn't just turn my back on God. I persecuted this church. I went hard after him. I wanted to put them to death. I would have voted to put Jesus on the cross. That's what Paul's saying here, isn't he? But his life changed forever because he encountered the risen Savior. He encountered Jesus on that road, and he was forever changed. And it changed his purpose. It changed what he did. Do you see what his task now is? Jesus didn't say, hey, I'm just going to save you. You just keep going on living however you want to now. No, he's like, I got a plan for you. The Gentiles, they need to hear about you, me. They need to go from darkness to light. They need to go from following Satan to following God. They need to understand forgiveness and have their lives sanctified, which means being made more holy, being made more like God each and every day. And so that's the message that Paul is now going to proclaim. This good news that Jesus brings forgiveness
for our sins. He covers the penalty for them. But he also doesn't just leave us where we are, but makes us more like him each and every day. And Paul's clear about how that happens. It happens through Jesus' death on the cross and through his resurrection. That's how Jesus pays the price for our sins. But Jesus doesn't stay dead. On the third day, he raises from the dead back to life so that we may also come back to life. So Paul uses his story to point to God's story, to what God is doing in his life. And he's there trying to convince everybody who's there just to be entertained that they've got something else they need to hear. And he ends by saying, this is good news, not just for our people. Verse 23 says, but Christ must suffer, and that being the first raised from the dead, he would proclaim light both to our people and to the Gentiles. And if you go back a few chapters earlier, you'll find that every time Paul seems to say this word, it seems to raise this feeling in the crowd. A riot breaks out back there. Now things get volatile there in the court. Here's what happens. As he said these things, verse 24, in his defense, Festus said in a loud voice, Paul, are you out of your mind? Your great learning is driving you out of your mind. But Paul said, I'm not out of my mind, most excellent Festus, but I'm speaking his true and rational words. For the king knows about these things. To him I speak boldly. For I am persuaded that none of these things has escaped his notice. For this has not been done in a corner, King Agrippa. But you believe the prophets. I know that you believe. And Agrippa said to Paul, in a short time, would you persuade me to be a Christian? And Paul said, whether short or long, I would to God that not only you, but all who hear me this day might become such as I am, except for these chains. So Paul proclaims that this is for the Gentiles too. And Festus, who's kind of been off to the side, right? He speaks up. He's like, whoa, 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 whoa. This is a backwater province. He probably did something wrong to come be the governor here, right? And you're telling me this kind of off-the-beaten-path religion that you're proclaiming, it's supposed to change my life? This isn't just for this little pocket of people. You're saying that your message is for all of us, that all of us need to change, that I need to change my allegiance and who my Lord is and who I'm following and who I'm letting be in charge of my life. And Festus is taken aback at this. He's like, you must be out of your mind, Paul. You must be crazy to think that. And this actually is the response that Paul says usually happens. We get to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, starting verse 22, and read, for Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. It's a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. And so for a Greek mind, this might seem foolish, this might seem folly, but for those who get it, they realize that this is ultimately wisdom. And so Festus is left to wrestle with this, and then Paul turns his attention back to Agrippa. And he, probably politely-ish, says to Festus, I mean, Agrippa, after all, he is my audience for the day. If you learned in anything in junior high English, right, you speak to your audience. He's identified his audience. He knows who it is. He's speaking to Agrippa. He talked to Festus earlier. He spoke to him a different way. But today, I'm talking to Agrippa. And then he calls Agrippa out, doesn't he? He puts him to task. He doesn't let him just kind of sit with it. He says, no, Agrippa, you believe the prophets. I know you believe them. And what Paul is saying is, if you believe the prophets pointed towards this. If you believe them, you have no choice but to believe this. And now Agrippa is on the defense. Now Agrippa doesn't know what to do. He just wanted to hear a story. He just wanted to be entertained that day. But now conviction has come. Now he's got something to wrestle with. And Agrippa has to make a decision. And they don't want to stay in this room any longer. What we find is they'll leave. Agrippa, Festus, they're getting out of there, right? We do that sometimes when conviction comes in our lives. Like, I want out of here. This is uncomfortable. I don't want to stay in the room anymore. But you know what? They might be able to get out of the presence of Paul, but they ain't getting out of the presence of the Holy Spirit. That conviction's following them out that room. Paul did his job. Paul was supposed to share this message. And the Holy Spirit's doing his job. And now Agrippa and Festus and all those in the room have to decide how they're going to respond to God. Paul had a story to share. But we all have a story to share. Each and every one of us have a story to share. And you might say, but Pastor, I've only been a believer for a short amount of time. I'm not ready to share that story. I don't know enough to share that story yet. Yes, you do. You know exactly enough to share that story. I have a friend named Clayton. He works for the BSM for Texas Baptist. He was the BSM director at Tarleton State for a while. And they were averaging one new believer a week at Tarleton State University. And as they did, he had a rule. If you make a baby, you raise a baby. That's a good rule, right? But if you make a Christian, you raise a Christian. You disciple them. You don't just lead them to Christ, but you help them to grow in their faith. And so he taught me a lot about what you do to disciple a brand new believer. And what he says, the first thing is within the first 24 hours, you sit down with them and you read your Bible with them. So everything you would do normally in your own devotion time, you sit with this new believer and you do it aloud so they can just see what you do. They can start to learn what it means to read your Bible and to pray together. And then the second thing, which is what goes with what we're talking about this morning, is within a week, you need to be able to share your story with somebody. So they would help that person know how to put into words what happened to them, know how to express that. And so within a week, they would find an opportunity for that new believer to share what happened to them with others. Why? Because new believers, people who follow Jesus, we read our Bible, we pray, and people who follow Jesus, we share this with other people. That's who we are. That's what we do. So they would throw what they called Matthew parties. Matthew the tax collector, right? You bring all your sinner friends together. And he would bring all this new believer's friends together, or some of them. They'd have pizza, they'd hang out, and they'd give the person a chance to share their story. Because really, what do we need to do? To be able to share what God has done, we just need to be able to put in words what God has done for us. It's that simple. Now, you might say, okay, well, that's fine. They might have a remarkable story to share, especially if they're in college, they came to faith. Later in life, they probably got some past to talk about. But my story, it's not all that remarkable. It's definitely not like Paul's. I didn't see a blinding light on the road to Damascus. I mean, who's going to want to hear my story? Well, you think about it. The thing that makes Paul's story remarkable wasn't that blinding light on the road to Damascus. The thing that makes Paul's story remarkable is that the creator of the universe, the one who made all that is, the God who has always been and always will be, even when I turn my back on him, he still loved me. And he came to this earth, humbled himself, and died on a cross for me. That's the remarkable part of the story, right? That's the thing that people need to hear. That makes this blinding light on the road look a little pale in comparison. So for me, at 6 years of age, sitting in my dad's blue Oldsmobile on the road on the side of Grace Presbyterian Church while my brother was practicing baseball in the field behind it, as we were having this conversation about what God has done, it's that part of the story that makes it remarkable. The six-year-old me responding to that story pales in comparison of what our God has done for us. But nonetheless, God did it in my life. And it didn't just stop there, right? He transformed my life. God saved me from other things as I went through life because I was living and following after him. There's still remarkable parts of that story. So don't feel like your story is not remarkable, because you have a remarkable God to share. So we need to share this story. But it's not just this story, right? It's not just that moment when we come to faith in Christ. But this is a continuing story in our life. God continues to be at work in our world. And so we need to share that story too. Look around you. See what God is doing in the world around you. And share the story of what God is doing. Have your eyes open to what God is doing. And so then when you share those stories, don't leave God out of them. Leave him in the details of those stories. So when I tell the story of when Lori and I met, it's as much a story of God answering specific prayers and God providing as it is about us falling in love. I mean, it is about us falling in love, but there's so much that God has done in that story as well. And so if you haven't heard it yet, come catch me. I'd love to tell it. It takes a while. But remember to put God in the story. Don't forget that part. And if you're having trouble seeing God in the story, if you're having trouble seeing God at work in your world, then read the Bible. I find the more we read the Bible, the more we see who God is, the more we see how God has been at work in the world, the more we see him at work today. So read the scripture, see who God is, see how he's at work in the world around you, and share those stories. Because there's more stories to tell. I think probably one of the more significant ones in my own life happened my freshman year of college. My freshman year of college was not an easy year. I went off to Howard Payne, about 5 hours from home. And in the course of that year, I lost my uncle, I lost my granddad, my brother's fiance passed away, and then a week later, my grandmom passed away. Not an easy year, right? And I'm 5 hours from home, sometimes just wanting to be home. And that summer, after my freshman year, I felt like I needed to go overseas and do some mission work. I had already felt called to ministry when I was in high school, and that's just something that I felt like God was leading me to do. So my older brother, one whose fiance had passed away, and I joined a team in North Africa overseas, and they kind of cut us off from all communication back home, except for the one email we got that said, my mom has multiple sclerosis, right? We need one more thing this year, right? And so I'm dealing with all of this. But I'm also trying to be faithful. I'm trying to be where I am. I'm trying to serve how God's asked me to serve. We're making friendships with college students there. I'm trying to share the gospel with them. I started noticing something in North Africa. It's a mainly Muslim area. And so there's a call to prayer 5 times a day. And so we've got friends in this fairly large city, but we're in one part, so we get to see them as we're walking down the street sometimes. And that call to prayer goes off sometimes, and guess what? If they don't know we're there, they just keep walking down the street, right? Like, it's not even going off. Actually, a lot of the city just kept walking down the street. A good Muslims, they're going to go stop somewhere, they're going to go to the mosque, one or the other, they're going to take some time and pray. But most of the city just keeps going on like nothing's happened. But if they're hanging out with us, if they're spending time with us and the call to prayer goes off, guess what they do? They're bringing out their prayer mat. They're laying out. They're going to the corner and they're praying. Or they're saying, okay, I'll be right back. They go to the mosque a block over and they come back when the prayer time is over. And so when it's convenient, when it's for show, when they need to look religious, they do. But most of the time, they just keep going on with their lives. So one morning, I was eating breakfast in the apartment we were renting for the summer. Frosted Flakes, no milk. The only way to eat Frosted Flakes, by the way, right? You put milk in them, the sugar goes in the milk, it ruins the whole thing. Frosted Flakes, no milk, please. That's a conviction in my life. Frosted Flakes, no milk. Eating it for breakfast, reading my Bible, and praying. And as I was, God said, you know, y'all aren't all that different in America. You know, maybe not Muslim, right? But that's how you treat Christianity. When it's convenient, or when you want people to see it, you do it. But most of your life, you just go on living like this doesn't even affect your life. Oh, yeah, I was convicted too, right? And at that moment, God said, this is your task. You've been called to ministry, but I want you to go to the church in America and say, this isn't just something for one day or a couple hours of your life. This is the way we live our lives. This changes our lives forever. Just as Paul got that message, it wasn't just a message of forgiveness of sins, but of sanctification. A message that says our lives are now forever transformed and changed by the God we serve. A life that goes from darkness to light. A life that goes from following Satan to following God. A life that is repented, that is turned, that goes a different direction forever. And ever since that summer, 2001, that has been a driving, shaping force in my life. See, God is constantly at work in our lives and our worlds. And when we tell His story and the story of how He works in our lives, it starts to change others' lives. It draws them in, right? Stories have a way of doing that. They draw us in. They make us want to know more. We want to get to the end of the story. So this week, as you look around your world, it doesn't have to be something grand and amazing. Just look and see where God's at work. And take the time to share that story. So I've told you some, I think, good stories in my life, but one from this week, right? At night, before bed, I like to watch TV, so most of the time that looks like opening up the computer. This week, I went to ESPN Plus. I wanted to catch out a 30 for 30, so I pulled up one of the sports figures that I grew up watching, and I wanted to see this story. And I watched a little bit of it, didn't have time to really watch the whole thing, turned it off, went to sleep. Had some self-control, right? But the next morning, I kind of had this uneasy feeling, right? Like, you know, the story wasn't bad. They were, you know, some sports figures, but yeah, this one wasn't horrible. But man, they used a word I never use. They used probably, I would call, the chief of the curse words. And they probably used it 100 times in that 30 minutes that I watched the night before. And it just left me feeling uneasy the next day. And I wanted to see the rest of it, right? I want to see what happens, right? Stories want us to see the end. But I felt convicted. I was like, if that's how this is going to keep going, I don't need that to keep coming in my head. And so I closed that window out of my browser. I'm not going back to that story. I'll listen to some other stories. I'll watch some more. But that one's not good for me. So whatever it is, big, small, remember that God's a part of our story, and we can share that story. So you all have stories you want to share, you have to share. You just can't wait to share. Every day you have them, right? Something funny you saw, something that happened at work, something you heard on the news, that dad joke that you just got to tell somebody. And we don't even wait for a chance to put them into a conversation appropriately, do we? We just push them into a conversation. We've got a story that we have to share. Will you share it this week? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your forgiveness. We thank you that we are not who we used to be, not by anything that we have done, but because of what you have done. Lord, may we not be able to hold that in. May you give us a longing and a desire to share this story this week with somebody who needs to hear it. And Lord, may we be faithful. Because Lord, we know you are, and your Holy Spirit will work and move in that person's life. And Lord, we pray that they will come to know you because of it. Lord, we long to see people. We long to see people's lives changed by you. May we see it this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us this morning at South Park Baptist Church Online. We're so glad you joined us for worship today. If you need to respond in any way to this service, if you need to know more about what it means to have Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, for Him to completely change and transform your life, to forgive you of your sins, I'd love to talk to you more about what that means. If you want to be a part of our church family, We'd love for you to be a part of the South Park Baptist Church family. Even if you can only join us online for now, we'd still love for you to be a part of us. If you need to respond in any way, please don't hesitate to email me at chad@southparkchurch.net. I have a few announcements this week. The first one is we will have Surviving the Holidays, which is a grief share event. It'll be led by Lori Bertrand. It'll be this Tuesday from 4:30 to 6:30. And it's a time to really get together and talk about how we go through the holiday season after losing a loved one. So if you've lost a loved one in recent years, we'd love for you to come and join us for this event. I hope it'll be a meaningful time for you. Next, we are going to have a country Christmas. It'll be a time for us to get together as a church family, but also to invite others as well. It'll be an outdoor event on December the 11th at 6 o'clock. That's a Friday night. We'll have a few fire pits set up in the field behind our church. We'll have hayride, some hot chocolate, coffee, s'mores, if you want to bring some cookies to share. We'll have music, Christmas music. I'll tell the Christmas story. But hopefully it'll be a great time for us to spend together outdoors and be able to celebrate this Christmas time. And the last thing is we're planning on having a Christmas Eve service, and many of you have already filled out our survey, but if you haven't filled out that survey, we'd love to know if you are planning on coming to our Christmas Eve service. You can find a link for that survey in our email, on Facebook, or on a QR code here at the church building as well. We're so thankful that you worshiped with us this week. As we go into this week, heading towards Thanksgiving, may I pray these words over you. They come from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, starting in verse 16. May you rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Amen.